morning, everybody. That was Grand Trunk Railroad with Some Kind of Wonderful. Apparently, there were some settings that needed to be redone, so let's try and pretend that that didn't even happen. And it's really 11 o'clock and not 11:04. And you're listening to Bulls Radio, WUSF 89.7 HD3 Tampa, 1620 AM on campus and streaming worldwide at bullsradio.org. You're listening to Ried Rants on the radio today on Saturday at 11 o'clock. This is the Saturday before, well, actually, spring break is actually in force. I am staring out to an empty, dark beef O'Brady's. It's amazing the building's open today, but I am grateful for that because I get to do my show. I hope you're grateful too. So today, we will talk about a few things. I've got a couple movie reviews for you, and I had posed a question last week, and that question was, do you think that movies of today emulate or dictate our social norms, our society's norms? Now, if you want to get a hold of me or submit your comments or suggestions or questions, I welcome that. And you can post a comment on Facebook at facebook.com/readrants. That's R-I-E-D-R-A-N-T-S. Email is ried183@yahoo.com. We've also got an account on Instagram and Twitter, which are both Ried Rants. So if you want to reach out to me, I would love to hear from you. If you want to submit your input for questions of the week that we are discussing currently or in the past, we can obviously revisit those comments that you have from previous questions. Now, today I'm going to start off with the movie reviews because I typed it up that way. And I watched a couple of movies, and these are all rental movies, so hopefully there's no, I will tell you if there is a spoiler alert. I mean, I don't want to spoil the movie for you guys if you haven't seen it, but I do want to put in my two cents of what I thought about the movie. I did watch The Good Dinosaur recently, and that is a Disney Pixar film. I was a little reluctant to rent this movie because it appeared to me to run the risk of being a movie where all the, quote, good parts were in the trailer. You know those types of movies. You see this really long trailer and you see all these really great gags and there's nothing more to the movie than that. You're like, oh my gosh, is this it? And I'm sorry, I don't like saying gosh, but I haven't come up with a suitable substitute yet. And I like to keep everything very G-rated on the radio, not only because it's required, because it just never know who's listening. I don't want to be teaching anybody any words that they really shouldn't be saying. Anyway, back to the review. So the movies were, you see everything that is the best part of the movie in that two-minute trailer, or sometimes some movies have several trailers, and you're like, okay, in the 4 minutes of trailers I've seen, or the 6 minutes of trailers, I've seen everything that there is to see in this movie. And then you just sit there for 2 hours wondering, okay, why did I waste my time watching this thing? This movie, The Good Dinosaur, was a lot better than I had expected it would be. I had put it off, you know, obviously, because I just didn't want to even waste the few dollars it was to rent it, but I thought it was really cute. There were some funny gags in it, and you'd have to just watch the movie. If you appreciate computer-generated animation like I do, and you like Disney Pixar, you'll probably like this movie. It is another movie sort of like, what is it? I can't even think of it now. The one with the kid and the dragon. Toothless. Anyway, it could be a movie that's more, you know, it's less of a princessy, you know, being rescued, I hate to say this because it's sexist, but girly type movie. You know, this is more for everybody. It's not just talking about princesses and stuff like that, but I thought it was cute. There were some funny things in it. But one thing that I thought was really, really bizarre was there's a scene in it, and this is a spoiler alert, so, but I'm wondering why in the world that they had included a scene where the two main characters, the dinosaur and the caveman, or cave child, were tripping. They apparently had ingested berries that were hallucinogens, and it shows a little bit of that, and I'm thinking, okay, this is a kid's movie. Why in the world are they including something like this? That was just too weird. But I, other than that, I did really like this movie, it, and of course it did include the boilerplate elements of every Disney movie where one or more parents dies in the first 5 minutes of the film, and there's that inevitable scene of self-sacrifice that makes you just get all choked up inside. At least it makes me get all choked up inside. So, but I would recommend this movie, especially if you like other Disney Pixar films. The other movie that I had watched recently, well, let's save that one for later. Let's save that for later. Let's go ahead and talk about the question for this week. Now, the question for this week is, do movies dictate or emulate society's norms? Now, even though I had given a little bit of a foreshadow on this question last week, sadly, I did not get any response. And unfortunately, even my best efforts to go ahead and post it on the Facebook page and try to get some response was not very good either, because I posted it this morning. I meant to post it yesterday. And I don't know when people are normally more on Facebook, but I think early in the morning is bad. So, and I wanted to wait till later in the day. Waited so long, it was the next day. So, anyway. But I still wanted to talk over a few of the things that I was thinking about on this subject. You know, back in the 50s, just about everybody smoked in the movies. You know, when you would go to a movie, you would see people dressed a certain way. Way back when, people actually dressed up all the time. Women wore gloves and hats when they went out into public. Again, we've got people that were smoking all the time, because this is before that they had actually realized, well, it was publicized, before it was publicized that smoking was so dangerous or hazardous to your health. This is also the time where females were virgins until they were married, and when they were married, the baby making began almost immediately. In the house, the wife stayed at home, and the husband was catered to in many respects. Nowadays, almost no one smokes in the movies. It's an exception for a female to be a virgin, and marriage and bearing children are held off until after the career goals are met. Or at least that's the idea of the movie. So I think it's kind of funny if you think about it. I'm wondering if the movies are just saying, okay, well, this is what we want to tell people, this is what we expect, or this is what's going on. You know, everybody was smoking back then. Everybody got married early back then. And nowadays, you've got movies that are showing, you know, safe sex, and women are not getting married, and men are taking on a different role instead of machismo. You know, it comes from all angles. You see all sorts of diversity in movies now, and there is depiction of people from many different types of sexual orientation and different ethnicities, and the players just run the gambit of this, and I think that that is evidence of how far we've come as a society and how we have widened our view of what surrounds us. So I think that's good. I think that sometimes it can confuse people. I think it can also enlighten people, and unfortunately it can also offend people. And the sad truth is that people can be offended by the littlest things. The things that you wouldn't even think would be bothersome might be bothersome to somebody else. So, and I think that's just education. I never knew certain things when I was younger, and I can't think of a good example. But there are certain sayings, like, for instance, I had heard somebody in a talk. If you guys don't know, I am in the entrepreneurship program, and we listen to people, and we try to help them with their problems sometimes. So I'm listening to this person explain what they're wanting help with, and he kept using a phrase that I kind of found offensive, but I don't know that other people would actually find it offensive. I did speak to a friend of mine who also thought, whoa. Now, this phrase, and if you don't know the history behind it, it may not bother you, or you may not think that it's bad, but this guy kept saying, we want people to drink the Kool-Aid. And I was like, what? Do you know what that means? Do you know what the history of that is? I think maybe I was in a unique position because I actually did a presentation and a paper on Jonestown, and I did a lot of research on it, and I found things that were, you know, it was a very horrible, horrible event, and people drank the Kool-Aid. So I think it's poor form. Me, personally, again, the disclaimer for this show is, this is Ried Rants, this is my opinion. Everybody's opinion differs, and, you know, so I'm sharing mine. But I think it's poor form to say something, to refer to such a tragedy in that way. This was a man who was very charismatic, and he had a lot of followers, and they believed that it was okay to drink poisoned Kool-Aid. And hundreds of people died, and I just think it's a horrible thing to refer to when you're trying to get a point across to someone. Again, that's just my opinion, and your opinion may be different, and I don't want to argue about it. If you want to share your thoughts, I welcome your thoughts. That's great. But that's, you know, it's just the things that we go through, you know, it's kind of, think about it. 20 years ago, I might not have thought that there was a problem with that phrase, but now I do. So it's just part of learning, and that's what I'm saying. Like, when we're watching movies, if you know more about more things, if you're more knowledgeable, there are going to be issues where you're more accepting of, and issues where you're thinking, oh, gosh, I can't believe they did that, or, oh, I'm really glad they did that in the movies, or what have you. So I think that sometimes the movies, when we see TV shows also, and movies, it's a platform to get people to accept something or even to desensitize them to something. Now, someone had given me a little bit of feedback on this, and it's a little confusing the way it was sent over to me because it's a little piecemeal, so please bear with me on this. But this person, who is a listener, said that it used to be bad behavior in public with scorn, but unfortunately, due to the shows like Real Housewives of New Jersey, where we saw some idiot flip a table over and create a name for herself, we saw more and more people feeling that they just absolutely positively have to get their few minutes of face, well, of fame in on the camera, that 15 minutes of fame, when in fact they're just regular people. And this listener brings up a good point, how the Kardashians, gosh, that's a hard word for me to say, have become this point in our culture where, oh gosh, we've got to know what this family's doing. Who really cares? I just could never understand the people that follow the lives of celebrities and they end up being, you know, this stalker type person or so embroiled in what's going on in someone's life that they don't even know. And they don't even know that what they're seeing is an actual accurate depiction of what that person is or what their life is like. I never could understand that. But what this listener is talking about is basically he's saying reality TV is part of the decline of our society because everybody's lobbying and you know, working towards getting their, becoming famous. Hey, I'm on viral YouTube video, or I got on TV, or look at me, I'm so important. And some of these people are real jerks. I listen to some of these people and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, do you have a brain in your head? But, you know, again, this is me. You might be thinking that of me. You know, so you never know. It's kind of weird when you're faced with somebody who their mannerisms are diametrically opposed to yours, or you're thinking, why in the world would somebody do that? I think that in this day and age, it's important to be careful what you do in public and what you post up on social media because it can come back to haunt you. Yeah, it might be cute when you're 18 or 20 or 15, but when you're 30 and you're doing something really crazy and it's on the internet and somebody searches it and finds it, that could be bad. I remember thinking, gosh, this back in the days before social media, when parents used to take naked pictures of their babies and you see the stereotypical scene. This is something you've seen in the movies, too. Oh, here's little Johnny, and he did this, and he's, like, in a diaper or naked, and it's like the mother's showing that to the girlfriend. That's kind of what I think about some of the stuff that people put up on social media. It's like, yeah, you're laughing now, it's cute now, but wait till you get older, and you don't want anybody to see this kind of stuff. You know, what this listener is also saying is that it's a vicious cycle because there's always somebody trying to one-up the person before them. They want to be better than the predecessor or the last person that got their name up in light, so to speak. So I can relate to that. I can understand that reality TV... Honestly, I don't understand the fascination with reality TV. I don't like reality TV. The closest I get to reality TV is still more like documentaries or informational type shows, like some of the HGTV, you know, how to design on a dime or Caesar with, what I don't even know what Caesar Milan shows are called, but stuff like that. For me to watch somebody like, what is it, Dance Diva Moms or something like that, it's like, why do I want to waste my time watching this kind of thing? Now, it could be different, too. I mean, think about it. You're in school. You're going to school full-time. You've got tons of stuff to read. You've got homework to do or studying because, you know, when you get out of high school, it's not homework anymore. It's studying. You don't want to waste your time on this kind of stuff. At least, I would think not. But I remember a time when I got sucked into daytime television. And you had to watch General Hospital. You had to see what was going on. And it's funny because I've come across people who watch soap operas. And it's like the same players, years, decades later, going through the same stuff that they went through before. It's just kind of funny. Anyway, but so I want to go ahead and do a little song break here. I want to see if we can find something. Oh, this is a good song. We'll go Holding Out for a Hero from Frau Frau. And maybe I'm saying that wrong, but this is from the Shrek soundtrack. All right, we're back now. I love that song. It's got a cool feel to it. I just, you know, I like some stuff that sounds a little different. Anyway, also, you know, movies sometimes have really good soundtracks. Anyway, something that I wanted to continue on with the do movies dictate or emulate society was something that the listener John had also mentioned. he talks about shock value, and that's what everybody's interested in, is, you know, just how shocking or different something can be. It's not really qualitative. It's not quality. It's like, how can I shock them? And this kind of goes back to one of our subjects from several weeks ago about how movies, they seem to think that vomit is a necessary part of a movie. I mean, almost every comedy you see, somebody is regurgitating or something. I don't get the comedic value of that. And to me, it's like, oh, gross. And I think maybe that's what the listener is also talking about, is like, how weird can I be? How shocking can I be? Because I want to go over the top so then everybody knows who I am and I can be forever memorialized because I did this really over-the-top thing. And just, you know, hey, do something else. Do something that, like, is contributing to society instead of just, hey, you know, I did this really weird thing. Hey, look at me, look at me, look at me. I think that's part of the problem with social media. Everything is like, oh, look at me, look at me, look at me. All right, so we did have somebody else chime in on our Facebook page, and she had said that art emulates societal behaviors and cultures, and it also helps to propagate it. Now, she, from what she wrote, I am thinking that she means that not only does it dictate, but it does also emulate. There's no hard, fast rule of, hey, movies are telling us to do this thing, or movies are telling us that we do these things. She seems to think that it's a little bit of both. So I could see that. That would make sense also. And it could also depend on the movie. I mean, obviously, and I'm talking fiction. I'm talking total fiction. I am not talking documentaries, because documentaries are actually trying to look at some social problem I think it's always a social problem. I don't know that I've ever seen a documentary that's a raid about something. I think that they're always out there trying to get the word out on eating better or having a smaller or carbon footprint or any number of things that there are out there for documentaries. Now, what I was going on to about the movies as far as what I had prepared, I think that it's sad. To me, it's sad that a lot of the movies have stopped being stories. They stopped telling stories. To me, a story has a beginning, middle, and end. Obviously, you know, you've got the first 20 minutes or so of a movie where you've got the setup, you've got to learn the characters, you've got to learn what's going on. And then you've got the problem to be solved in the middle. And then you have the wrap-up in the last 30 minutes or so. Now, I don't know that a lot of movies are doing that these days. It's like, okay, let me just sit on my duff for a few hours, 2 hours, and watch this show, and it doesn't tell me anything. It just is a way for me to sit around and spend some time and watch these people on the screen. I think that a movie should be a story. And I don't understand what has happened to the writers. I don't know if this is some sort of new strategy and movies, or somebody thought, hey, you know, this is what it takes to write a movie now. Let's refer back to the Disney thing. It seems like Disney thinks it's part of the movie that they got to kill off a parent in the first 5 minutes. Maybe somebody's teaching writers out there that you've got to just have this great ride. And honestly, sometimes it's just not a great ride. I mean, I can understand. I would be less upset if the movie was this really great movie and then the ending was kind of like, okay, where's the ending? I don't know where it is. We didn't wrap up anything. I could forgive it if there was this great journey to get there. Well, at least I think I could. I'm not actually sure. You never know what you're going to do until you're in the thick of things anyway. But, I just don't want to sit there. I want to be entertained. And this comes back to the problem I have with what happened to comedies. Where are they? Where are they? I would like to know exactly where they are, because what I see that are, I'm doing a lot of Netflix, and I see this genre, select a genre for the kind of movie that you want to watch or the kind of show that you want to watch. Yes, I know streaming Netflix is not really good for movies, but I'm going to go ahead and make my point anyway. You see these things that are coded as comedies, and they're not comedies. They're dramas, or they're a horror flick with a couple of funny things in it. I mean, I watched something that was coded as a comedy, and I don't remember which movie it was. Oh, yeah, it was Freaks of Nature. We talked about that a few weeks ago. And it's like, okay, yeah, there are a couple of funny jokes in this movie, but it's not a comedy. People, zombies are eating people. You see, like, guts and innards and stuff. It was gross. And I can forgive that if it's funny. Like, Shaun of the Dead was a little gross, but Shaun of the Dead, I think, was pretty funny on that really dark zombie-eating kind of genre way, But, I mean, really, it's really difficult to find comedies now. And it's even harder to find a comedy that's actually funny. Because, again, we're going back to the stock value of bodily excretions and being gross or being saying something that's shocking or over the top. I think that people have come to rely on that kind of stuff, and it's just not necessary. I think it's a crutch. I think that there are people that have written really good stuff, and I would hope that they're still around. And if you have any great movie suggestions, I'd love to hear from you. Really, seriously. Even harder still is trying to, well, we already talked about trying to find a movie that's actually funny. What I've also noticed a lot about the movies that are available now are a lot of them are depressing, or they're post-apocalyptic. The world is going to end. There's somebody killing everybody. There's an explosion. There's a catastrophe. You know, isn't there enough bad news? Can't we see some other stuff? I mean, what is it with the, let me look at this train wreck kind of thing. There's also the big movies with the boogeyman, and there's some malevolent spirit in the house trying to talk to the kid, or there's some old myth that comes to life that's killing everybody in town. I mean, really, show me some funny stuff. That's just me, I guess. But, this is all, of course, fine and dandy because I've got an idea of what I like to watch and how I like to spend my spare time. And you guys are definitely going to have an idea of what you like and what you want to watch in your spare time. So, I could be committing the crime of thinking everyone's of like mind, and of course they're not. That's what makes everything interesting, because people have different views and they think about things differently. I wanted to go ahead and go over some of the stuff and kind of like see if I can get any feedback and talk about how, movies, I think, play a big role in our lives now, and I think that we need to be careful, what our kids watch and how we think about movies. I remember when I was a kid, I watched Fun with Dick and Jane, and this is the original version, not the remake with, what's his name, Carrie, Anyway, I remember leaving the movie theater, and the adult that had taken me, he said, okay, now, you guys, and it was me and my siblings, and the person says, hey, you know you can't go out and steal stuff like that. And I thought it was funny that this person thought that we would actually think, let's go rob banks, and that's okay, and let's rob people blind, and this and that and the other. But in a way, depending on how, where the child is in their development, they actually might need to kind of have someone tell them, no, that's not acceptable behavior. It's a movie. It's not real. It's something that somebody made up. I mean, who knows? Who knows? So, I think that it's important to have a little bit more fun in the movies, and fun being comedies and having jokes that aren't everybody being gross. I just, whatever. I'm at a loss today. And I am also going to give you guys another song, because we are going to segue into the next movie review. Oh, here's a fun song. I know I've played it before, but we'll do it again. Cover of the Rolling Stone by Dr. Hook and the Medicine Show. I love that song. I think that's such a fun song. So, I just realized I have not read the PSA for today, so we're going to go ahead and do that. The International Solar Energy Society will be hosting the USS Solar Energy Fair on March 26th from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. at the END Hall of Flags. The event will feature keynote speakers from the Clean Energy Research Center and Sierra Club, local solar vendors, and environmentally friendly organizations. Complimentary lunch will be served at noon. The event concludes with an expert panel, Q&A, and graduate student research presentations. Find the USF Solar Energy Fair on Facebook for schedule information. All right, so we're back now. It is 11:43, and you're listening to Ried Rants. This is Bulls Radio, WUSF 89.7 HD3 Tampa, 1620 AM on campus and streaming worldwide at bullsradio.org. If you want to reach out to me, I'd appreciate your feedback. Feel free to email me at reed183@yahoo.com. That's R-I-E-D and the digit 183@yahoo.com. We are also on Instagram and Twitter and on Facebook. So, the other movie I wanted to go over that I had watched last week was He Never Died. Now, this movie left me thinking, where's the end? The wrap-up? Where's the story? Where's the wrap-up to the story, which is what we were talking about before. Where are the answers to the plethora of questions that the movie posted? I think this movie is an example of a great idea that it could have been done better. There's such a thing as being too cryptic, in my opinion. This movie has some fight scenes that are a little like a train wreck, where you don't want to look, but you have to look. Kind of gruesome. The premise was interesting, and I won't spoil it for you if you haven't seen it yet, but It was kind of cool. It was kind of cryptic. It was, the fight scenes. There was this guy who was, he wasn't a troublemaker, but he was the guy. You didn't want to mess with this guy. But at the end of the movie, there were questions that just were not answered. You didn't know who this guy was, where he came from. Well, it tells you a little bit of that. But there are elements in the movie, it's like, what is going on? And again, I think if you watch this movie, or if you have watched this movie, you might be thinking to yourself, well, wow, that's a really cool idea. That's a neat premise. But it wasn't sewn up properly. It wasn't examined properly or gone through properly. It's just, it was missing a lot. And maybe they didn't want to make it too long, who knows, but, you know, when you spend, and I don't remember how long this movie was, but I think some of these movies that are like 2 hours and 20 minutes, it's gone as the 90-minute movie unless it's a kid's flick. But you, at the end, you're like, what? That's it? You know, it fades to black. You know it's the end, and it's like, are you serious? This is how you're going to leave me with this thing? I don't get it. I just don't get it. And this is part of the reason why I don't really go out to the movies anymore. I rent everything because I don't want to sit here and spend $10 to get into a movie and walk out thinking, okay, why did I sit there and listen to that for all that time and nothing happened? You know, it's really weird looking out into an empty depot for 80s. For you guys who have never been on campus, the radio, the studio is facing the Beefo Brady's that's on campus, and usually I see people milling about and people eating lunch and stuff when I'm here, and it's just like, it's almost a ghost town. I went over to one of the other stores earlier before the show, and everything is closed down, and I don't know if it's because it's Saturday, but definitely people are getting their spring break on. Yesterday's class, out of 50 people in the class, only like 23 showed up. So I think that some of those people were just like already on spring break. I think it causes a little bit of a problem for projects that are due too, because some people, they want to get everything done and out of the way before spring break so they don't have to worry about it. But there are sadly, there are things that need to be done on the break. And there are people like me and some of the other people that I have in my classes that are like, yeah, this is just going to be a time for me to catch up on stuff. I'm going to be able to get that reading done. I'm going to be able to get that paper done. I'm going to be able to get that project started. It's really sad when we're supposed to be resting. All we do is think, oh, gee, let me fill this time with stuff that I didn't get to do earlier. Oh, we think, oh, gosh, if I'm not overachieving and doing something every moment of every day, then I'm a slacker. You know, come on. We got to take some time to, you know, relax, do the things that you like to do, spend some time on you. You know, I know it sounds corny, but it's important. Get out in the sunshine, even if you're just sitting there. Now, I don't know how many people listen on the radio. On the radio? On the internet. But we're in Florida, and today's high is 81 degrees. It was a little chilly this morning at like 62, which is probably a big joke to all those northerners up there. But, you know, down here, we haven't really had much of a winter. Usually February is the coldest month, and I was pretty disappointed. Well, not really disappointed because I don't like the cold, but there were very few cold days that where it stayed cold all day in February. I think the kind of neat thing here in Florida, though, is when you're having a chilly day, and when I say chilly, a lot of people think it's nice, like 70 or 65 degrees. The great thing is the sky is so blue and so clear. And if it's sunny, it's just fabulous being outside, because if you're out in the sun, it's not too hot because it's a chilly day. During the day, well, forget it then. If you're not exercising, well, forget it then. You know, lately, though, it's been super duper windy. You can get bowled over by the gustiness lately. And it makes it difficult to go out and do some things. But now I've totally lost my train of thought. Oh, yes, doing things for you so then you feel recharged and re-energized. You know, being outside is always a good thing, in my opinion, because sunlight works as sort of a natural antidepressant. If you get enough sunlight, I think it's over 20,000 lux for, I don't know if it's 10 minutes or 15 minutes. I'm going to have to do some research on that and get back to you guys. But it's, you know, this is how you can help feel better is by being just being outside and being in the light. And I think that's part of the reason why they come up with some people are affected by a seasonal change. I think it's called SAD, seasonal affective disorder, or something like that, where the shorter days make people more sad because they don't have sunlight. The darkness kind of depresses them, I guess. I don't know the nuances of this disorder or anything like that, but I think that it's important for all of us to identify what we like to do and do that thing and do it often and make time for it. Because if you wait until you get that project done, get all that studying done, get your work done, you know, take care of the kids, take care of the spouse, whatever, take care of the pet, it's important that you need to take care of you. That's all I'm saying. You know, if you like baths, sit in the tub. You know, get some lavender bath salts. If you like getting out on your bike, get out on your bike. Go out for a walk. Take the dog. The dog will be very thankful and probably less bothersome if you're getting out on a regular basis. So, we will close on that. I'm going to see if I can do some research on SAD, just because I think it's important, because I want to make sure that everybody does what they need to do to take care of themselves. Well, you know, I can't make sure of that, but I can help widen your knowledge based on how important it is to do stuff for yourself, because I think that we get caught up in the grind and trying to do everything all the time that we lose sight of enjoying our lives. And, you know, this is converse to a movie which, you know, you want it to end on nicely, in a nicely wrapped package. In life, you do want to kind of like enjoy the journey and not so much focus on the end result. At least that's what I think. So, you are listening to Bulls Radio on WSF 89.7, HD3 Tampa, 1620 AM on campus and streaming worldwide at bullsradio.org. I thank you for tuning in, and I will talk to you guys. I believe it's next week. I am not sure if the show is going to be on because of the hours for the center where the studio is located. Again, I encourage you to reach out to me via email, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. And we are going to go ahead and close out with a song. I'm not going to go crazy. I keep playing the same songs over and over, but let's go here.